On hot copy, following the string of losses of Manny Pacquiao, Brian Viloria, and Nonito Donaire, Pinoy boxing suffered another setback early this week as Ray Boom Boom Bautista lost to Mexico's Jose Ramirez. Some analysts say it may be time for Bautista to retire.
Yet another heartbreak for Pinoy fight fans as Ray Boom Boom Bautista falls to Mexico's Jose Ramirez. Boom Boom was knocked down in the first round following a left-right combo by the Mexican. The Pinoy bounced back in the eighth round when he managed to stagger Ramirez. But the Mexican kept control of the late rounds to win by a split decision. Boom Boom is the fourth high-profile Filipino boxer to suffer a loss in recent months. The streak began in December 2012 when Juan Manuel Marquez knocked out Manny Pacquiao in their fourth encounter. The first time the Pac-Man has been stopped since he suffered a TKO loss to Medgoen Singh Surat of Thailand back in 1999.
No!
Earlier this month, Brian Viloria lost his WBO and WBA flyweight titles to Juan Francisco Estrada of Mexico after coming on the wrong end of a split decision. And just last week, Nonito Donaire was outclassed by Cuba's Guillermo Rigondo, who took his WBO super bantamweight belt after a unanimous decision win. Experts believe it's time for Boom Boom to hang up his gloves.
He's good at the regional level, that's it. Agree naman sila, sabi nila, this was going to be his last fight, win or lose. Now he lost, and so he's retired.
Wala naman talagang pupuntahan na si Boom Boom, ilang ano na eh. Pero siyempre, masyado na siguro sobra ang investment nila doon sa bata, tsaka binigyan ng malaking expectation.
But in the cases of Viloria, Donaire, and Pacquiao, they say fans should not worry since even the best boxers in history have all suffered losses.
We never give up on our fighters. Alam mo na, one loss does not mean. Muhammad Ali lost so many times, yet up to today he's known as the greatest. A loss does not necessarily mean that you're finished as a fighter or that you're a paper fighter or a paper champion. Hindi naman totoo.
The analysts are confident the elite Pinoy boxers will be able to bounce back in their next fights.
And joining us on Hot Copy, boxing analyst Ronnie Nathanielsz. Good day, Ronnie.
Good day.
Good to see you. Well, we got a bit of you on the story, but we want to dig deeper into this issue. It's really nagging a lot of sports fans to see our Pinoy boxing heroes fall one after another. I mean, it was one thing to be shocked when we saw Pacquiao go down in December. It's another thing to see our other boxers who are supposedly our next generation of heroes, you know, falter. Let's talk about Boom Boom first, the most recent one. You were there in Davao.
Yes.
Highly anticipated fight. You know, the fans were out there to really support him. TV ratings were off the charts as well. It was more than people expected to really watch what this kid has in store for us. But tell us what you saw in the ring.
Well, he has deteriorated.
Okay.
And that's because of wear and tear through all of these years.
But he's a young guy.
He's comparatively young, but he's taken a lot of punches.
And he started early,
I guess. The trouble with Boom Boom is he gets hit too much.
Okay.
He gets too, because he has the mentality, if you hit me, I'm going to hit you right back. And he leaves himself wide open.
Open. Okay. So it's a brawl, basically.
So he's basically a brawler. Mm-hmm. He has a couple of flaws. Mm-hmm. He has no head movement whatsoever. Even Manny Pacquiao pointed that out before. He has no good footwork, no lateral movement. So he just stands in front of you and wants to punch.
Okay.
Punch. And that's not going to work.
Would you say that he's become complacent through the years, that it has worked for him? He's beat some pretty decent opponents with that style. And I guess I distinctly remember interviewing Manny and asking him what he could say about Boom Boom. And he really did say he lacks this. And he said that 4 years ago. So, I mean, even though if Boom Boom hears all these advice, maybe even from his coaches in his stable, how come he doesn't apply it?
Well, he hasn't the capacity to do it, apparently, because, you know, if you look at Boom Boom, his neck is a little long.
Okay.
He's a little long, so he can't really move. He doesn't have that in his system, in his reflexes. And once it's ingrained, it's so hard to change, TJ. So I think, I told Tony Aldeguer 2 years ago, I said, Tony, Boom Boom is good for the regional level.
All right.
The Asia Pacific, the international, but he's not going beyond that for sure.
Okay.
And Tony realized that.
But they still gave him a shot.
He gave him a shot, but he said before this fight, this was going to be win or lose, your last fight.
Really?
Yes.
That was the decision of the stable, and that was the decision even with Boom Boom.
Yeah, Tony and Mike. Of course, it's very difficult for a fighter to want to retire.
Yes, because give me one more chance.
Yes. That's what he says. But Tony is determined to, because he doesn't want him to get hurt. God forbid anything happen to him.
Of course. I mean, and we've seen accident with Z-Gordon.
Accidents before, right. So he doesn't want that to happen again. And besides, you know, Tony is an unusual individual, Tony Aldeguer. Mm-hmm. He looks after his fighters. And he's not a manager who takes percentages from them. No, mm-hmm. he gives them. He's got four cars.
You're talking about Boom Boom.
Boom Boom. He's got four cars. He's got two houses. Mm-hmm. He's got enough money in the bank. He's got a newborn baby, and he's got a wife. So he's got everything. He's got some businesses going. So mm-hmm. Tony believes this is the right time to quit. Pay attention to your family, your newborn baby, and continue with your businesses. Mm-hmm. Michael offered, Boom Boom can be a part of our promotions if he wishes to.
Okay.
So his future is assured, and I think that's mm-hmm. the smartest decision they made.
And that's relatively, you could argue that that is successful for a lot of those boxers from the province who aspire to be a professional, to, you know, get their families out of poverty. And he obviously
has done that.
He has
done that. Mm. Because of the guidance of Tony and Michael Aldeguer, you know. They don't just allow their fighters to do whatever they want. Mm-hmm. Tony Aldeguer, I know, has the passbook. When they put their money in the savings account, he keeps the passbook.
He's like a father more than a manager.
Yeah. So if you want to withdraw money, you have to go to Tony and tell him what the money is for before he gives you the passbook. So that's really the manner in which fighters should be protected.
All right, so that's Boom Boom. I mean, we all saw so much potential in him the last 3-4 years, but unfortunately, it got stuck there. And as a fighter, he was, would you say, 2 one-dimensional? Yeah, he had a power punch.
Yeah, he had
knocked
a power
out a few people in the States.
In fact, this guy, Ramirez, said his left jab hurt him a lot, and that was a strong point of Boom Boom, the left jab. But if you notice in this fight, he hardly threw the left jab. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering whether that old injury was bothering him again. Mm-hmm. That could have been.
I remember he broke that wrist before.
He was operated. He had surgery on the wrist, and they had to put in something, an implant, a piece of steel or something.
All right. Well, we wish him well. He's given us a lot of pride.
Yeah.
He's been a part of Pinoy Pride for many fights as well, and he's even fought in the U.S. and done so well. So,
and you know, TJ, he's an exciting, charismatic fighter.
Yeah, he's a nice kid, too.
He's a nice kid. Mm-hmm. He's not mayabang. Some people think he's mayabang. Mm-hmm. He's not. Mm-hmm. He's really not. He's a nice kid, and he's given of his best. Yeah. What more can you ask from a person?
All right. Well, that's Boom Boom, and pretty much that's his career, as you said. Let's move over to the other three boxers that really shocked us with their last fights on the ring. Well, it's been a while, but let's go back a bit to Manny Pacquiao's fight in December. What happened there? Fourth fight with Juan Manuel Marquez. Big debate whether it should have happened or not, going to another one, right? But then again, we saw him hit the canvas for the first time since he did against... if I'll try to pronounce this correctly, Medgoin, right?
Yeah, Medjet 3K Battery.
There you go.
Or Medjet Singh Surat.
There, Singh Surat, yeah. And that was in 1999.
Right.
I'm sure with the year, but I don't know how to pronounce his name. But 1999, Ronnie, that's 14 years ago.
Right.
14 years. We haven't seen Manny hit the canvas, and we saw him hit the canvas hard and cold.
Yeah. Well, I haven't solved the questions in my mind about Juan Manuel Marquez.
Okay.
I have a problem with Juan Manuel Marquez because I watched him, and Diane and I did the fight when he fought Floyd Mayweather. Mm-hmm. He was little. Okay. He was small.
But at the same weight class that he did with Pacquiao, right?
Yes. In fact, a little higher. So he was very small compared to Mayweather.
Okay.
Then I saw him before the Pacquiao fight. He was full of muscle, ripped and ready, strong, broad-shouldered. And I wondered, what happened? Mm-hmm. And he didn't go up in weight, despite looking bigger and muscular. The other thing is that, you know, in 3 previous fights, he didn't drop Pacquiao even once.
He's hit him several times.
Yes, Pacquiao dropped him 4 times. Mm-hmm. Now suddenly, with one punch, he puts Pacquiao to sleep for about 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. Where did this power come from?
Mm-hmm. Although, remember going back to that particular punch, if I may, you know, try to debate this and sit on the other side, Manny was coming in, there was his body's momentum, and it was really, some people say, lucky punch, and here comes Juan Manuel Marquez on the right side.
But Pacquiao to be out cold for 5 minutes and fall like that flat on his face. Mm-hmm. I mean, Barrera has hit Pacquiao. Mm-hmm. Eric Morales has hit Pacquiao. Hector Velasquez has hit Pacquiao. Oscar De La Hoya has hit Pacquiao. Okay, he mm-hmm. never went down. Mm-hmm. And the progression of Marquez began in the third fight, mm-hmm. which I thought he won.
Okay.
Then he was getting bigger. And then in the fourth fight, he was huge comparatively when you look at the previous fight. So I have unanswered questions in my
so
mind.
So it raises questions for you.
It raises questions for me because Angel Heredia mm-hmm. was his strength and conditioning coach. Mm-hmm. You can go to the internet and look about Angel Heredia.
And you'll see what people are talking about him.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, he was involved in not such good activities, mm-hmm. you know, okay. peddling performance enhancing drugs. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying he did that.
Right.
But there are still doubts in my mind about...
Because of his presence in that camp.
Exactly.
And seeing what you saw yeah. compared to before.
Now, I wish that the World Boxing Organization, the different organizations, mm-hmm. at least in championship fights, will insist on random drug testing. Nonito Donaire is doing random drug testing. Mm-hmm. Floyd Mayweather and the Ghost Guerrero are mm-hmm. doing random drug testing. Brian Viloria said he's ready to do random drug testing. So mm-hmm. with Nietes and several other fighters. So why can't the World Organization institute random drug testing so that all of us will know it's a level playing mm-hmm. field and we won't have any doubts about the results of mm-hmm. a fight?
Then why can't they? Or they refuse to?
I don't know why. They keep blaming. It says it's up to the commissions. Mm. Because it's fight under different commissions. Mm-hmm. But I tell them...
You mean the Las Vegas...
The Las Vegas Commission, California,
the Texas,
New York, all okay. of that. But my argument is this. The fighters are not fighting for a commission title. Right. They're fighting for a WBO,
title.
IBF,
exactly.
WBO. Yeah. So you set down the rules.
They can.
You can.
Legally they
if
can.
You wish to.
Yeah.
If you want
if
to.
If they wish to. All right. Well, but on the side of Manny, did you see any fault on his part? I mean... You know, if a fighter wants to throw his strongest punch at you, but if you defend yourself well,
yes,
you won't get hit
yeah,
that hard.
You know,
I mean, what happened to Manny then? Was he could have been a little bit overconfident? Did he not have the right fight plan coming into it?
No, I think he got a little carried away.
Okay,
if there's any reason to blame him, mm-hmm. is he got carried away because he knew there were 10 seconds to go in the fight.
Okay.
Marquez's nose was broken. He was a bloody mess, his face. Mm-hmm. He would probably have got knocked out in the next round. Mm-hmm. Manny jumped into it. And imagine that punch came with 1 second to go in the fight.
In that round, yeah.
Knowing that there were 10 seconds, he had battered the guy. There was no need to push it to the ultimate in that mm-hmm. particular round. Mm-hmm. But, you know, he wanted to put an exclamation mark to this series, especially because of so many people, including myself, who thought he lost
yes.
the third fight. So.
Mm-hmm.
We have to take part of the blame, I guess.
I mean, that's the warrior in Manny.
Yeah, that's the warrior.
He just
in
really
Manny.
Wants
right,
to
right.
prove himself in yeah. moments of adversity. All right, so that's Manny. And then after that, of course, thankfully, Nonito won his fight in December.
Yes.
Right after that. But after that, here comes another loss. Brian Viloria going up against Juan Francisco Estrada. This is the one in Macau, if I'm not mistaken. A lot of anticipation for that fight because there was a pro debut of the Chinese Olympic
yeah.
boxer as well. What happened to Viloria? I mean, we've seen him climb steadily
up
back into quality
right.
again.
Right.
I remember we had this conversation before you were telling me of what happened to him way back when one of the fighters he knocked out cold passed away.
Right.
And it may have affected his psyche.
No, actually, he didn't pass away. He was traumatized, brain injury.
Yes, right, brain injury.
But he
correct.
Came to special ringside mm-hmm. for the fight when Brian Viloria won
okay.
the WBC light flyweight mm-hmm. title against Ortiz.
Okay.
So he was there.
Right.
So he recovered and Brian and he were embraced before the fight.
Great. But I remember after that accident, his next fight that he won, he knocked somebody out.
Yeah.
And you were telling me this, that people in the rings had heard him say, oh my God, did I do it again?
Yeah.
Right? Because he's had, so in other words, are we worried that since then, it might keep creeping back into Brian, that he'll hold back his power because he knows how strong he is?
No, actually, Brian, as him himself told me more than once, mm. every time I enter the ring, my life is on the line.
Well, all the boxers know that.
All the boxers
know
that.
That.
But he says that.
He says open. It. It's,
he
it's,
says it
yeah, openly.
Openly.
Okay.
You know. Now, in this fight, which we also did mm. for ABS-CBN, he was winning the fight. The first
okay.
five rounds he won, clearly. Mm. He was outboxing the guy. Then somewhere down the line, I don't know what happened, he wanted to slug it out with Estrada.
And that Which is not Brian's style.
He's not a
slugger.
Yeah. That was his mistake. And Estrada, even the ringside announcers were telling me, Estrada was amazingly strong at the end of the fight, stronger than he was at the beginning. So, I don't know.
Raises questions as well for you?
To my mind, it raises questions.
Okay.
That's why I've even told Mr. Tony Aldegar, why don't you insist that both fighters, you know, undergo random drug tests before the fight? If you have nothing to hide, what's wrong with having drug tests?
It's not like it's going to take a whole day to extract the blood or urine.
And you extract a little blood, no problem.
Okay.
You know. But anyway, but Brian, tactically...
there were errors.
Yeah, he didn't fight the right fight. He could have outboxed that guy all the way. And he himself admitted after that that he made mistakes. It will not happen again. The other thing that bothers me about Brian Viloria's case, he trains at the Wildcard Gym.
Okay.
He's being trained by Marvin Somodio.
Okay. Not by Freddie.
A find of Freddie Roach, who was in Pacquiao's camp in Baguio. The kid is good. No question about it. But he doesn't have the experience. The know-how, the savvy of a Freddie Roach.
Okay.
And I would like to see trainers like Roach spend more time with fighters like Brian Viloria, who are world champions. You know, not allow an assistant, I'm not saying a mere assistant, but a young kid like Marvin Somodio, who's good. Make no mistake about it, I've seen him work. Work on Brian Viloria. Tactically, what can he tell Brian? You know?
Why so? Would you say that Brian's camp was... budgeting?
No, it's not. It's Brian and Somodio get on famously.
All right.
They are very
so they really get along.
They get along famously. They love each other, really. So that could be one of the reasons. And Freddie Roach is so busy. And you know, Freddie Roach doesn't spend too much time on fighters any longer. You know, the only one he still pays attention to is Manny Pacquiao.
Of course, Manny Pacquiao. Right. Well, we've got some more time to talk. And when we come back, we'll talk more about... in particular, Nonito Donaire, his loss against Rigondeaux, and really the future for Donaire and how he, I guess, has the pressure to carry the flag for the Filipinos right now as well. And we'll be having your questions, so tweet us your questions here at ANC Alerts for our boxing analyst guest, Ronnie Nathanielsz, and Hot Copy. We'll be right back. With us is boxing analyst Ronnie Nathanielsz. In a bit, we'll get him on the line. We're talking about Ed Tolentino to join us as well. But Ronnie, Nonito Donaire... interestingly enough, he had apologized for his performance against Rigondeaux. He himself admitted what he claims were, overlooked in his training and his camp. It boggles the mind, though, why you wouldn't scout an opponent properly of somebody at the caliber of Rigondeaux as well.
You know, sometimes people say that Manny Pacquiao has distractions. That's why his performance is affected.
Okay.
Nonito is so engrossed with his... son that is due on July 21st, his whole life surrounds that boy, that baby boy that's going to, you know, be delivered on July 21st. So he has, as a result, I think, not shown the kind of focus that he showed in the past.
That we're used to seeing from him. Okay.
The other thing that concerns me is that Robert Garcia, his trainer, only spent the last week with Nonito.
Only one week
before the fight.
And we're used to seeing Pacquiao train with Roach for the last 4 to 6 weeks, but
exactly.
This is 1 week.
Now, that's because Nonito trains in one part of San Francisco, and Robert Garcia trains his fighters in another part.
Okay.
So for him to get to the gym is a long drive. So he doesn't do it.
So end to end from the city.
Yeah, end to end. So he has a problem there. And so if your trainer is not there with you, not looking at film, not analyzing the opponent, you have a problem.
Yeah. So he was getting in shape, but...
Yeah, but he took things for granted. He took things for granted. And on top of that, of course, you know, Nonito has a very high pain threshold.
Okay.
He was operated last Friday.
All right, yes. Okay. The other day,
A bone spur in the shoulder, plus two... torn tendons or ligaments. Hey,
It was that bad.
Uh-huh. I mean, that a bone spur can end a basketball player's career.
Yes,
right.
As well.
So if that's in your shoulder and your power,
we know he's got a strong right jab.
Right straight.
Yeah.
The right straight that put down Toshiaki Nishioka.
Right.
You know, so he was depending on a one-punch knockout to end it all. It didn't work because, one, Rigondeaux was extremely fast, Two, excellent footwork. He was a typical amateur boxer.
Yeah.
And he picked his spots. He had obviously studied the tapes of Nonito.
Yeah.
Totally. And they came with a very, very organized game plan. Mm-hmm. And that's what told. Mm-hmm. That's what told in the end.
Okay.
Now, I am convinced, without any shadow of doubt, that all these three fighters will come back. That's what my contention is. We must not put our fighters down.
Okay.
Just because they lost one fight doesn't make, it's not the end of the world.
Although they were big losses.
They were big losses
because big stage.
We had expected so much from them. Yeah. You know, that reached a certain, but you know, you lose some.
Yeah.
It happens. It mm-hmm. happens. It happens in any sport. So you got to give them a break. We have to stand by them and support them, mm-hmm. not put them down.
Mm-hmm.
So I think Nonito Donaire, after the operation, is going to fight sometime later this year.
Mm-hmm.
Bob Arum told me he might fight Victor Terrazas, mm-hmm. who recently won the WBC Super Bantamweight title, beating Christian Mijares by a split decision. Or he may move up and fight Juanma Lopez.
Yeah.
We don't know what's going to happen. Garcia thinks Nonito should stay at 122 because mm-hmm. he can handle the weight
mm-hmm.
and he can put away the opponents. So we'll see what happens. But right now, he is not talking about, he's going through rehab and mm-hmm. he's doing it diligently.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing on his mind is the baby.
Is the baby, definitely. That's his focus right now. All right, we'll see you very soon back here in Manila. Thank you so much. Ed Tolentino there.
Thank you.
All right, Ronnie, well, to wrap things up, as Ed said, he's got a lot of confidence in the next generation.
So
I remember talking to you the other day. You said you mentioned some names that I've never heard of, but you seemed really excited.
Okay. Genesis Servania, undefeated.
Mm-hmm.
Bob Arum watched a tape of his last fight and said, this kid's fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
I want him on the next card. He's going to fight in Macau.
Okay.
Okay, on July 27th. Then you have Milan Melindo, who's fighting Estrada for the title, mm-hmm. undefeated.
Mm-hmm.
Then we saw last Sunday on Studio 23, the fights we covered on Saturday,
mm-hmm.
Arthur Villanueva, tremendous fighter, undefeated too. He was in a war with Demesilio.
Mm-hmm.
He won. He's another prospect. You have Jason Pagara, who's fighting also on May 25 on Pinoy Pride.
Mm-hmm.
Young fighter, except that his problem is he's in a weight category, junior welterweight, which is loaded with talent in the world. But one can never say he's only 20 or 21 years mm-hmm. old. Then you've got his younger brother. There are lots of fights. You've got Saludar,
mm-hmm.
Froilan Saludar, who this morning, I had a story out, he's going to fight. It's a mandatory challenger for the world title of Muruti Mitilani. Mm-hmm. So there are lots of fighters mm-hmm. on the fringes. I think rather than be depressed as a result of the losses, they will step up
mm-hmm.
because now they know the opportunity is theirs. And I know, I talked to Michael Aldige, with Boom Boom retiring, now he does not have what seemed like a burden to figure out fighters that Boom Boom can fight
mm-hmm.
and thereby prevent other fighters taking that position of Boom Boom.
Okay.
So the opportunity is there. I think these boys will grab it.
All right. And I think, I guess, the pressure now lies on the promoters, the stables, to really take good care of their fighters and pick their fights well and strategize their careers. As you said, the door is wide open.
Yeah. John Real Casimiro has been fighting abroad all his fights since he won the title from Lazarte in a riot mad fight in Mar del Plata, Buenos Aires, Argentina.
Mm-hmm.
Now he's defending his title again. But all his fights have been abroad and he's won.
Mm-hmm.
He's kept winning. I wish that boy can defend his title here in the Philippines.
Well.
But
so the Pinoys get to see him.
Get to see him.
Yeah.
He's a tremendous young kid. He's only 22 or 23. He can hit like a mule.
All right.
So, you know, he's another great talent.
Yeah. Well, we see the excitement in you talking about this next generation. We've heard the excitement from Attorney Ed and truly that there is a lot in store for Philippine boxing, and we do hope the best for our big three, Pacquiao, Viloria, Donaire. They will bounce back.
No question in my mind.
Pacquiao,
they're not sure who he's going to fight.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be Bradley, apparently, against Marquez, although I understand that's not a done deal as yet. But whoever Pacquiao fights, and it's going to be either in Macau or Singapore, he's going to win, no question in my mind.
And then, of course, you got Nonito after the baby is born, then, of course, Viloria as well. Well, lots of exciting stuff up ahead for our Pinoy boxers, and thank you for uplifting our moods.
my basic philosophy is don't put our fighters down. Mm. If you understand the burdens, the sacrifices yes. they make, and guys who never laced a glove in their life, put them down, mm. that's unfair. That's not right. That's not right. And they are our mm. countrymen, for Christ's
Absolutely.
Sake.
Absolutely. Well, very well said. Thanks for joining us, Ronnie. Till the next time, a pleasure as always.
My pleasure.
Okay.
We'll I like see your you again tie, soon.
Thank
TJ.
You. And that's Head Start for today, folks. I'm TJ Manotok. Thank you for watching, and have a nice day, everyone.